in Holland and Germany is a consultative troubleshooter. I like that. And of course, he's a key barn design expert. Vetvice have made over 1,000 plans, renovating old barns for robots, putting new barns in from 60 cow units up to over 2,500 cows. The barns have received many awards over the last few years, labour efficiency awards in Canada, low-cost building awards in Holland, innovation design in our very own Scotland last year, and an Udder Health Award in Holland. They're also the, and this came up quite extensively actually 2 days ago in Scotland, the go-to guys for the positive pressure tube ventilation advice, and they work very closely with the guys in Mole Valley. So lots to talk about. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce Bertjan.
Okay. Thank you, Tom, for the introduction. Somebody in the audience said just to me, they grow you big, they build you big in Holland. So I always start explaining why we are so big in Holland. We are so big in Holland because we have only a very small country and we live there with 17 million people. So the only way for us to grow is to grow up. So. Okay, designing the perfect accommodation for your herd. Like Tom explained, I'm a veterinarian. I'm also a barn design advisor, so somebody to whom nobody listens. Joep explained this morning. But I think it can even worse. Having three children at home and a wife, they don't even listen to me as well. So, but I think getting along with independent advice on barn design, we gain a lot of experience working closely together with the customers, Holland, abroad, UK as well. So I saw some customers in of England as well. So that makes a lot of fun. And it gives us a lot of joy. Okay, do we have to build a new shed for a good profitability? Just the ranking, just new, every September, October, we have a ranking. Everybody's walking to the post, to the postman. Okay, what rank I am this year? And we're quite a little bit, quite proud on the fact that number 1, 2, and 4 are customers with it, but we help them. We help them designing a good shed for their milking cows. This morning we talked about genetic potential. I agree with that. All the cows, all the Holstein cows, have the ability to produce much more milk than they at least on average do in many countries, also in Holland. So what did this farmer do? Was it just because of the new shed that they increased milk production? They all increased about 1, 2, 2.5 thousand liters, a rolling herd average a year. So no, it's not only the shed, but it's also, of course, genetics. It is feeding, it is feed management, everything. But on the other hand, building a new barn with all the wishes of the cow built in, that helped them really to increase milk production. And I have to say, add to it, all three farms, the 1, 2, and 4, all have used sand-bedded freestalls. So sand-bedded freestalls are really paramount regarding cow comfort, milk production. This morning, Matt also explained, the more cows are lying down, the higher our profit over income. The title of today, Optimum Lifetime Performance. Okay, we can talk about milk production. We have a higher risk, or the chances bigger that those animals of those farms have a higher profit. But back to lifetime production. This farmer, it's a farmer with 120 milking cows using two robots, also working on sand. And he is already for 6-7 years averaging a lifespan production of over 50,000 liters. So before the animals go to McDonald's, go to the slaughterhouse, they produced 50,000 liters, and I think that should be the goal. Two more lactations, milking all the cows, and yes, a good, well-designed shed can help with that. 2 years ago, he was the number two of Holland. He culled 15 cows with an average lifespan production of 75 liters. I texted him, congratulations, and he sent me back, yeah, you can congratulate me, but I had to cull 5 potential 100,000 liter cows, which I got not pregnant. So, okay, he was not even so happy with it, because yeah, the cows were sound, healthy, so there was actually no reason to kill them, except he could not get them pregnant. Okay, so yes, a new shed can help you to increase profitability. I'm a veterinarian. Joep is a veterinarian. Why are we involved in the design business? Yeah, it has to do with working years and years with our clients, with our customers, and seeing a lot of so-called technopathian, so also so-called techno diseases. Diseases related, we have to treat diseases related to housing conditions which are not optimal, like tick hocks, you explained this cow this morning, lumps on the back. We visited too many farms, too many sheds with poor ventilation. We are talking already for 30 years about claw health. Yeah, we have to improve claw health. We still have to deal with 30, 40% lame cows every year, clinical, subclinical. What about housing? Housing has a major influence on claw health, solar ulcers, white line diseases. So why not improving the housing conditions? The barns top ranked with sand bedded free stalls, why did they increase milk production? What do you think? Why? What was the main factor? Was the key driver? What was the key driver for? They got rid of the lame cows. A lame cow doesn't eat that much. So if you can improve your claw health, you automatically gain a lot of milk production. Prolonged lying times, yes, we have more milk, but there's an optimum in that as well. So if they lie down for 24 hours a day, they're not going to produce any milk anymore. So this cow got stuck in the freestalls. Fresh air seeking behavior, ventilation, we're going to discuss that later on as well. And this farmer, yeah, he also visited the workshop. Look, Bertjan, no overstocking for my close-up cows. Every cow has a freestall. I have 6 or 7 head yokes. So it's optimal. No, it is not optimal. Look at this standing animal. And we know, disservicing, Matt told us this morning, disservicing your dry cows, yeah, really hurts. This cow has a very big chance, big risk to get solar ulcers 2 months post-calving. Headbanging cows, Joep told you this morning. I see them as well in my practice. And we have to learn from our cows. This cow is telling us we need longer freestalls. So this was not the only hole. There were about 8 or 9 holes in the sidewall. But the farmer learned from his cows and designed, built a new shed with 3 meter long freestalls. Okay, back to the basics of our independent advice on barn design. We always take the cow signals diamond into account. Unlimited access to feed, water, space, light, rest, and air for every cow. For the high ranking animals, they will survive anyway, but also for the low ranking fresh cows, the lame cows. And we take the daily time budget of a dairy cow into account. A cow should lie down for 12 to 14 hours a day. Eating, she does for about 4 to 5 hours a day. Other things, like talking with the girlfriends, socializing a little bit, grooming, drinking short time. So actually, cows don't have that much time to be milked, for being milked. And of course, we build for healthy cows. Of course, we have to take the reckon upon the diseased cows as well. We have to take care for them as well. But we go for the needs of the healthy cows. Sorry, Tom. I take you again. So this was Tom.
Not in Italy.
No, after this journey in Italy. Another time, always funny, the show.
Luckily, Bertjan's very good at calculating.
Yeah, so that's the topic. Yeah? With the right calculation, the right materials, we got the result as desired. So we had to practice a few times with students and something like that. After 3-4 times, we took we took Tom, and he's still here. No, with the right calculations, the right materials, we got the desired design. That's what we think. But is that always the truth? This farmer invested 1 million euros in a new shed, and he phoned me. We did some advice on it, but he said, no, okay, that's enough, free stalls, etc., etc. I do it by myself. So what do you see? He was not happy. What do you see? Standing animals. A new shed, recently built. Standing animals. Free stalls 110, so our large animals do not fit. You can see it, it doesn't fit. So why did he phone me? What was the reason be? Standing animals, drop in milk production or not the milk production increase as expected. Dirty cows, lamenesses. Yeah, he had to change. He had to make a change again. Yeah? And normally, the only people who want to change are babies in with a wet diaper. Yeah? But also this farmer wanted to change. Yeah? He changed, had to change the free stalls. So yes, building a new shed can help, but let it be good. Yeah? Let it be good. The four cornerstones of a building plan. If we start talking with a farmer, we always take these four, actually five cornerstones into account. We start with cow comfort. We start to talk about labor efficiency. A new barn should be expandable. It should also might be changeable for other purposes. And we should build as cheap as possible, durable. A perfect shed, a good shed, is not per se an expensive shed. We have to keep that in mind as well. So the goals, cow comfort, a barn in which a healthy cow calf stays healthy. And if you have ill cow of an ill calf, she should rest and recover quickly. And we see also huge differences amongst our customers. Yeah? Get lame, stay lame, yeah, the principle. Once a cow is getting lame, we see big recovery rates between farmers. Once they have much more chronic lame cows, otherwise other farmers can take care of them easy because they have, for example, they have a big straw pack or they have a better cow comfort. So labor efficiency as well, 100 cows caretaken by one single person. Cheap, worth the money, durable, and expendable, changeable. Building for 100 means planning for 200. We always explain as well, if we are there with father and son sitting at the kitchen table, and for example, they want to build for 2 robots, we always make a drawing or talk about 4 robots. And then we tear the plan into 2. One is to be built, for example, next year, and the other half of the plan is to be built in 5 years or in 10 years. Yeah? So that we at least take the expandability into account. Cow comfort is actually the key. Yeah? Building for healthy cows, because we know one ill cow takes the same amount of time as 40 healthy cows. You agree with that? Yeah. So be sure we don't get ill cows anymore. What is the worst example of barn design that you have seen? That's a nice question. We can talk with that later, but that are the barns with enormous overstocking at the feed bunk. A few years ago, 4-row barns, 4-row of freestalls with only 1 feed fence were quite popular because of the cost. So if you ask me, what is the worst example of barn design that you have seen? Yes, building a shed, but only access to the feed bunk for 30 or 40% of your cows. Never build that. So why do we need a plan? Make the mistakes on paper. That's less expensive than in the building. And that's less expensive when the concrete is hardened out. Make it suitable, variable, expendable, and last but not least, affordable, and integrate again a long-term vision. Yeah? Building for 100 is planning for 200 or for 300. So, about expandability, did he had a good long-term vision? I think so. Yeah? You agree? So, he's building of he is milking two times 120 cows in this milking center, two groups of 120 cows. If you want to expand, all the areas are open. He can extend the barn, he can mirror the system, he can place an extra barn, so he can go up to 480 cows, 240, 360, 480. Then we need more special needs areas as well, so we can extend the special needs area. We need more young stock, more dry cow housing, so he can place an extra barn over there. More cows, they eat more, so we need more bunker silos. All the spaces are open for extra bunker silos. More cows is more manure, extra space for manure pits. So it's a well thought design. And this one, the old shed, no expandability. He wanted to increase, also some tie stalls here as well. So he built a new complex, new operation. What do you see? Can he expand? No. Can he extend the barn? No, because then the groups are too big in milking times. Milk shifts last too long. Can he expand it to that way? Oh, because the milk house, milk center, is too close to it. We have problems with putting a second barn next to it, because then we have to remove the bunker silos, and we have to remove the manure pit. So would this project have been more expensive when we integrated a long-term vision? I don't think so. I don't think so. Okay. Problems will cost you time and money, so invest in cow comfort. A narrow barn, well ventilated, paved floors, which actually are the best choice for milking cows, debedded freestalls, in this case sand-bedded freestalls, and well-designed stress-free calving line for the special needs cow around calving. When we make a design or we get a drawing for a second opinion, we always check the design by walking the drawings. We have to think in flows. The cow flow, the daily walking routes from cows to the parlor, from cows to the separation area. We also have to think about the cow flows, not only during the day, but also about the cow flows during lactation and about cow flow during their life. Yeah? When they are born, where do we raise them? What do we do with our 22-month-old pregnant heifer? Yeah? How do we bring her to the dry cow shed? All the flows we have to consider. The walking driving lines. So I forgot to say that the fifth cornerstone actually is also biosecurity. Yeah? If we build a new shed, we should avoid that we drive by with the mixer wagon over manure alleys. Yeah? Just to avoid spreading diseases like Salmonella, Jones disease, etc. It's a really big issue in Holland. We want to keep our feed lines clean. Biosecurity also means no calves housed in the same building as the adults. That's also biosecurity. Walking lines for ourselves, driving lines for the machinery, bedding, feeding, scraping, and we have a close look at how do we organize our labor routines. Where do we use our materials? Where do we get our information? Which animals are in heat? Farmers with a milking robot, how do we sort out cows easily? How can we separate the milk immediately of when it's needed? So check the design, think in the different cow flows. So key considerations when we consider a new shed. I want to discuss with you the milking parlor, because the milking parlor capacity and the choice of your milking parlor determines the layout of your operation. Robot barn, something about cow traffic and the different choices. Feed bunk space per cow, actually the layout of the barn. Ventilation, stress-free calving line, and free stall comfort. There were a few robot milkers. How many robot milkers are here? One, two, yeah, okay. Who is considering a new barn complex or a new shed with a parlor? Something? Nobody? A few? Yeah. The biggest challenge at the larger operations is waiting time, is milking time actually. Parlor milking, consider the milking times for your cows. on larger operations, we see that the milking times increase. So from cow's perspective, if we talk about the daily time budget, how many hours can we take a cow away from the shed for milking? Sorry? 10% of your time, 2.4, yeah, 2.5 hours max, divided by 2. So then we are talking about 1 hour milking time at max for the last cow to be milked. So if we buy a double 12 side by side, rapid exit capacity, you're young. How many cows you can milk in a double 12? 110 an hour, yeah, 96, 110. So what is the maximum group size in that case?
1 hour.
Yeah, but also 100 cows, 96 cows. Yeah? So if we decide to buy a double 12 rapid exit, group size should not exceed 100 cows. If you want to milk 400 cows or 500 cows, you have to make 4 or 5 groups with 100 cows. Yeah? That's the deal for those animals. So waiting is no one's favorite activity. And lame cows, you agree with that if possible. Last cows you're milking are mostly the lame cows and the cows with some problems. So that's one of the biggest bottlenecks on larger dairy farms. Yesterday we had also some farmers, they were milking three hours. I'm not going to ask you, but some farmers, sometimes it happened that the last cows to be milked have to wait 3 hours on their feet, yeah? Especially when they are sore feet. Yeah, then we see lower recovery rates and lower production on those farms. So cows don't have time to wait. So actually, when the milk shifts last too long, we have to milk in groups. And if we build a holding area, of course we do, it should be big enough. Per cow, 1.8 square meters. But if we build it, we take the biggest group times 1.2, so 120%. Yeah? For a little bit extra capacity, times 1.8 square meter. So cows don't have time to wait. So milk shifts last for max 1 hour, 2 times a day milking, 3 times a day milking, 3/4 of an hour. If we go for robotic milking, and we talk again about daily time budget, choose from cow perspective. Yeah? Free cow traffic for the cow is the best choice. Because we see less waiting times again. We see more meals per day. We have more mobility of cows during throughout the barn. We see more robot visits, not only milkings, but also refusals. We have more regular milking intervals. And there's always discussion. Yeah, we have more time, more cows to fetch. But that's really to discuss. Because fetching cows is not only a matter of the way we organize our traffic system. Eh? It also has to do with feeding, with the claw health, etc. So if you go for robotic milking, please choose for free cow traffic. On the other hand, if you go for guided cow traffic system, there's quite a lot of research done as well. We see especially much more standing times. Cow are just idle standing in the holding areas and waiting to be milked. And that can increase to 3/4 of an hour per milking. Yeah? So we don't have the benefits of robotic milking because still our cows are standing too long on their feet. We see less meals, more cows idle standing, less cows to fetch. Yeah, that's for discussion. Okay, time budget. Yeah? Maximum 1 hour per day away from feed and water and resting space. If you go for robotic milking, go for free cow traffic. Freestall barns, what is the main barn to build? Yeah. The base barn. We can choose for a 2+2 row barn, two rows of freestalls on both sides of the feed alley, head to head. This is how it looks like. What is the benefit of a head to head? You can see it here already. Sorry?
More lunging space.
Yeah. So we can build this freestall a little bit shorter compared to when we have a freestall against the sidewall. That's true. We have more lunging space. Cows like to lie opposite to each other. Yeah? They're social animals. We had some examples of Jersey farms as well. They first go and lie down in a double row, yeah? And then in the single row. And we don't have wind and rain inside the freestall, so we can just open our barn a little bit more. So that's a 2+2. If you see the layout, you can see as well only 50% of the cows have to use the cross alleys for lying down. So that makes us a very calm barn with very few cow traffic. Yeah, a lot of cows can lie down immediately after feeding or after drinking some water in the freestalls. So this is how it looks like, head-to-head. We have also the possibility to go for a tail-to-tail. And this is how it looks like, the drawing. We can go for a 3+3-row barn, 3 row of freestalls. And the layout, 4 meters, 5 meters, 3 meters, 3 meters. Every 15 to 20 freestalls, we would like to have a cross alley. This is a 3+3-row barn, so a 6-row barn, the central feed alley. Yeah, what do we see? What do I see?
Standing cows.
Standing cows. Why they are standing? They're not comfortable. This is just after feeding, after fresh feed delivery. Not enough feed space. So if we want to build a new shed, this is a key decision for your cows for the next 30 years, 20 years. Do we build for overstocking? Yes or no? This cows, our house is a heifer group, separate heifer group. They're housed in a overstocked feed bunk situation. So for freestall, every cow has a freestall, but we can only feed 65% of our animals at the same time. So what cows are waiting? Which one? Sorry? The heifer, yeah, there's all heifers, but here the lame one, archback, empty rumen, a fresh one. So these animals, and do these animals get the same feed? Do they eat the same? No, sorted out already. Palatability is already a bit lower. Okay, and also very popular is a 6-row barn, but then with outside feed alleys. Very popular on sheds with milking robots. Yeah? And we think with milking robots, because not all animals feed the same times, overstocking in the feed bunk has less disadvantages compared to parlor milking. Yeah? So that's the reason that this type of shed is built quite a lot. This is how it looks like. This farmer, 6-row barn, all open, very good cross ventilation, sand bedded freestalls, two robots. How many mastitis cases? Just one a year over the last 2 or 3 years. Yeah? 1 to 2. So going very well on this farm. He gained a other health award as well 3 years ago. Another example, perimeter feeding, outside feeding, 6 rows of freestalls. You can make a remark, yeah, but you have to feed your cows. Yes, you can build a new shed, but feeding stays important. Very shortly, briefly, 2 versus 3 row of freestalls per row of head yokes. Feed bunk space per cow, so we have overstocking, yes or no? When we don't have overstocking, we have more meals because cows are eager to visit the feed fence more often because there's more place. We have less displacements at the feed bunk. They don't meet dominant animals that much. We have a slower intake of feed and less feed sorting when we have a lot of feed bunk space. Another benefit, when we build a 2-row barn, we can consider self-locking head yokes. Makes it very easy to lock all the animals, 100% of the animals at the same time. And then we can vaccinate, doing peck check, for example, TB testing. So we don't need that big separation area compared to a large operation with only 3+3-row barns. 2-row barns or 4-row barns, 2+2, are narrower barns, so we have less animals per square meter, so they're also better to ventilate as well. And we have less manure per square meter. So when we go for tractor scraping, this is also better regarding claw health. In a competitive environment, cows eat faster and lesser meals. Some research done at transition cows. So if you build up a new operation and you say, okay, Bijan, I believe you, but yeah, I have some reasons to go for a 3-row barn. Okay, but don't go for a 3-row barn for your transition cows. Yeah. That's a disaster. Yeah. Matt explained this morning as well. So transition cows, yes, 2-row barn, 80 to 90 centimeters feedmug space per cows, because yeah, there's quite a lot of competition. Lesser meals, faster feeding, faster eating when we have overstocking situations. A nice film, nice video. Speed it up a little bit, eight times. Contractor is working, is paid per minute, so he is driving very fast. Has to drive very fast, yeah. And it was a guy with a lifespan production of over 50,000 liters for already 6-7 years, earning money. It's a 4-row barn with 2 feed alleys, 2 robots. What do we see at the feed bunk? No displacements, eh? They're quiet, just standing, feeding. Some about barn dimensions. 3 meters we calculate in between the freestalls for the walk alleys. Behind the feed fence we go for 4 meters. And as said before, take the feed bunk space into account. They really need 70 to 75 centimeters, and dry cows, we even could say here 85 centimeters. Why do Dutch farmers make the beds 110 centimeters wide? Optimal is 125. Nice question. There's a movement going that we also make them wider, up to 120, 125. But you can say Dutch farmers are freestall counters. They just build up a shed of 30 by 60, and they put in as much freestalls. But the 110, that's history. So we still have to handle some older operations where they still have 110. The new operation they built for 120, 170 and a half, 125. If retailers really want to demand a step change in cow comfort, should they pay some of the cost to update old buildings and kit? Poof, nice question. Should retailers build for something you get the profit of? So I doubt a little bit about that, because the drive to build a perfect shed for you and for your cows, should be there because of the higher profitability. Happy cows, happy farmers. Given a limited budget, is it better to invest on improving an existing farm building, or is it better to build new? Really depends upon the sizes. It's too easy to say everybody has to build a new shed. No, because if we remove sidewalls, if we make our beds wider, if we consider making deep beds instead of the rubber mats, if we place an open ridge in a lot of covered roofs I've seen in the UK, if we pay attention to the flooring, you can really update your existing shed. So the answer is depend. Okay. Don't forget cross alleys. Every 15 to 20 freestalls, we need a cross alley. Two per group. Why do we need two per group, at least? Yeah. Cows really hate dead ends. We as well, in the dark, in a city we don't know, for example. But we really do not like dead ends. Of cows do not like dead ends. There has to be the possibility to move around. Two per group. They should be wide enough, at least net 3 meters. So that's depending upon what are you placing in those cross alleys, out of parlor fields, brushes, water troughs, etc. Take a look at the water trough. How high is it? We place them on 60 centimeters. 60 centimeters. Cows love it. Not too high. No, 60 centimeters. So all the Vetvice barns, you can recognize, the waters are placed very low. 3 less freestalls makes this barn a much better barn. You agree with this? Yeah. This farmer again, as much as freestalls in it, but he forgets the accessibility of feed. So 3 less freestalls makes this barn always a better barn. Not saying we have to overstock, but it's better to just remove a few freestalls. With fewer cows, you have the same output in the same barn. We have to build for healthy cows. A good ventilation is required. Completely open. Cow comfort is more important than people comfort. You agree? sometimes discussion. We always say first the jacket and the hat and then the curtains closed and not the opposite. So every cow needs about 300 to 500 metric cubic meters per hour exchange of fresh air inside the barn. So why build walls in it? We always say concrete can cost you 3 times money to build it as long as it's there and to remove it again. So it costs you 3 times money. So don't build too much concrete inside your barn. Cow comfort is more important than people comfort. Something about natural ventilation. Go for open ridges continuously. A rule of thumb, 5 centimeters per 3 meters barn width. So yesterday we visited a 6-row barn, 40 meters wide. So 65 centimeters open ridge. And that was there, so they did a good job. The slope of the roof in Holland and also Germany, we typically work with 22 degrees, not saying that is the standard, no. Just give you the remark, don't build them too steep, over 28 degrees or less than 80 degrees. Incoming air should mix properly with the existing air of the barn air. And then we have a stack effect because of the open ridge and wind blowing over the roof and also the heat production done by the high-producing milking cows. And the warm air is going out over the ridge and also a little bit over the opposite sidewall. If we make the slope too steep and we have some wind, the fresh air is going directly to the open ridge, not mixing well. If we make it 18 degrees, we have the risk on drafts because the incoming air, the stack effect is less and the incoming air is blowing directly onto the cows or even also the calves. Look for high ground for maximum ventilation, minimum 50 meters in between buildings, perpendicular to prevailing summer winds, also to avoid heat stress. Sidewall opening should be high enough, 3.5 meters in a 2-row barn to at least 4.5 meters in a 3 or 6-row barn. We choose for adjustable curtains, better than Yorkshire boarding, because that gives less incoming air, especially when there is not enough wind. And natural cross ventilation works up to 30 to 35 meters barn width. So if we build our barns too wide, we don't have the optimal ventilation as well. Given the labor cost of a sick cow versus healthy, should we cull earlier and give sick animals fewer chances in the herd? It depends on management, and I would say try to avoid sick animals. That's an open door, but that would be my key, my number one. Given the labor cost of a sick cow, what is the optimal depth of sand in debedded cubicles? We go for 20 to 25 centimeters. If we go for a thinner layer of sand, we have to bed more often to avoid the risk of cows lying on the concrete. So 25 centimeters. Should high production dry cows be loose house for the full dry cow period? If not, how long? We're going to talk about it in a few minutes. Very good. So, built for healthy cows, what do we see on this picture? Yeah, the cows are standing. Yeah? Why are they standing there? Fresh air seeking behavior. They need oxygen. Yeah? Oxygen for the motor they're looking for. But it's a new barn. It's a new barn. Just 1 year old, 1.5 year old. What is the problem with this barn? It's 60 meters wide. Yeah, there's no problem with Jan. It's high and we have a large open ridge. They built a 6-row barn with another 3 rows on each side. So a 3-6-3 with 2 central feed alleys. Looking for high ground, what they did here. It was in Germany, close to the River Rhine. What's that? It's a dike. So they put a very wide barn in a pit or in a well. Yeah? So, and it was in springtime, we did a cow signals workshop, 80, 90 degrees. We see the first signs of heat stress, more standing animals, especially in this case, these animals were really looking for fresh air. 150 cows here standing at the back of the barn. Build open barns, okay, build them narrow and look for open ground. Prevention of heat stress during summer is key because we see too much problems after a certain period of heat. Do we have heat in Somerset here as well? I think so. Okay. In Holland we have about 20 days over 25 degrees bothering the cows. So we need fans as well in every barn. Also, maybe we had a discussion in Scotland as well. Okay, I think a little bit less, but here invest in fans as well. Okay, then we come to the loose house in the fresh, the stress-free calving line. This is a graph what displays, what shows us the daily risk of culling in non-pregnant cows by days after calving in parity. So that means how big is the risk that we cull her. And you see the highest risk for involuntary cull is the first 30 to 60 days post-calving. So invest in a perfect transition shed for your cows. We call it a stress-free calving line. Large straw packs, okay, we can discuss, has to be 5%, does it have to be 10% for your cows? That's also dependent upon, yeah, what do you want, what is the budget, and how well designed are your freestalls you can use for your dry cows. But 5% is minimum. We have three packs, the dry cows, the calving pen, and the fresh cows next to each other. One person can easily move one cow from one pen to the other pen. Minimal stress, high intakes. Here we have a smaller call of safety calving time behind the milking robot. This cow is calving. She's moved through the fresh cow pen. She's entering the holding area. She can be milked, and after milking, she's sorted out by the machine into the straw pack again. Works very well. Housing transition cows, keys to success. Do not overstock your transition shed. Eh? That lowers, impairs dry matter intake. Stable groups, because if we know if we add every three days a new fresh cow or a new cow to the group, we have a social turmoil for again 2-3 days. So these groups are never stable. So if possible, on larger operations, go for stable groups. Feed bunk space, we discussed. Debedded freestalls are key also for dry cows. Quite a lot of research done also in the USA. And they try to find the relations with ration, housing conditions, and post-calving performance. And what do you think? Did they find a relation with the ration? Almost none. Yeah? Housing conditions, overstocking, social turmoil were much more important. For post-calving production. Straw pack close-ups we discussed and built for some extra capacity. When we have 200 cows, how many calvings we have a week? 200 cows, about 4, agree? If every cow reads the textbook. And sometimes we have 8 or sometimes we have 12 in a week. And if it doesn't fit, we already have more calvings, and if we have more problems, yeah, we run out of time. It simply doesn't fit anymore. Okay, the cuddle box, Joep displayed this morning. We designed it in every calving pen because it really helps farmers to do the labor around calving efficient. If you put the calf on top of the feed, and we did some research on that as well, intake is higher. If we let a cow calf in the pack and we leave the calf with the cow, does she eat the first hour? No, we did that with camera research. They don't simply eat, they just take care for the calf. So, should high production dry cows be loose housed for the full dry cow period? If not, how long? Yes, no. Okay, it might be ideal. We have some issues regarding hygiene. We have some issues like labor. We have some issues like costs. So if we have excellent dry cow beds, freestalls, 135 wide, 3 meters long, no aggressive neck reel, we can house them perfectly as well in freestalls. At least the last 1 week, 2 weeks, I would house them in the dry cow shed. Okay, the last part of my presentation, and also about the daily time budget of a cow. Cow should lie down for 14 hours a day. Keep cow comfort and cubicle comfort is key. Keep the new farm, the new shed I showed you, with the farmer who spent a lot of money, and what at the end he was not happy with the result because of building too narrow freestalls. Freestall comfort is key. Cow should lie down for 13 to 14 hours a day. So some research, and here is sand, and here is mattresses, mark the difference in lying time. They can easily go up to 1.5 hours per day. Regarding hock lesions, we did some research, and we saw we have most of the damaged hock, 25%, on mattresses or rubber mats, also in brand new barns, because the mats are simply too abrasive for the hocks here as well. It's completely bald, it's reddish a little bit. And again, when did we see most of the healthy hocks? That was, again, in debedded freestall systems. Horse manure, sand, and dry compost. So go for sand, if possible. What are the advantages of sand? It's inorganic. We have lower somatic cell counts. 40, 50,000 cells is no exception. I heard also this morning from a customer in Somerset, milking 44,000 somatic cell count in sand beds. Low mastitis rates, 5, 6, 7% per year are no exception. We have excellent claw health. To say we get rid of digi, no, but it really helps to decrease the problems with claw health. We have low cull rates. Again, cull rates year after year under 20% are no exception. We have good grip on the floor. That's a very important one as well, because they use about 10 kilograms per day. They take out on their hooves. They spread it on the floor, the cows by themselves. So we have a very good locomotion. Hygiene, of course. Management is key, also in this case. Manager handling can be challenging. There are good solutions available. And one of these solutions is a flush flume system. Already 4 farmers in the UK are working with it. What's happening? The sand-laden manure is pushed by tractor or by an automated scraper system into the flume. When the manure drop-off occurs, the pump is running and flushing all the sand-laden manure into a settling basin aside of the barn. And at this channel, the sand settles. The tin manure runs off, and the tin manure is pumped over the flush line again. Works well. Simple system, not very expensive. Given the labor costs of a sick cow versus healthy, should we cull earlier and give signals? I answered that one. Go for healthy cows. Locking head yokes, restrict feed intakes. Nice question. The answer is no. Quite a lot of research done, but no. Research shows that if we house our cows in head yokes, the dry matter intake is lower compared with the barrier. What do you see at the barrier system? We have more social displacements compared to head yokes, especially when we have a little bit more overstocking. Yeah. So the answer is no. What's the cost of starling proofing a building, and how long will the return on the investment take? That's a nice one. That's a nice one. Yesterday we discussed it as well, the problems of starlings. We have it sometimes also with customers in Holland. Yeah, there's no research in Holland. Yesterday I heard that the starch content of a ration can decrease with 20% after you had some friends, some of these friends inside your barn. The cost of starling proofing a building, I don't think the return on investment will not last that long, because make your barn starling proof, that's just a matter of mesh, is that the right word? Bird nets. But everything has to be closed. You have to close the doors all the time. We have to close the ridge. So what's the cost? I don't have research on it, but if there's a problem with starlings in your region, I would make it starling proof. Okay, Freestall dimensions in centimeters, you get handouts afterwards, but go for wider freestalls, 135 in your dry cow pen, milking cows, 125. But again, it depends upon the type of animals you house. Yeah? Do we talk about crossbreed? Do we talk about Holstein cows? Or do we talk about Jerseys? Yeah? The difference, that depends. 110 is too small. We only have space for a goat, or a calf, or a small Jersey heifer. Yeah? But every third or fourth robot is empty. We see it also in new sheds. Yeah? The most important message, take the size of your cows into account. Yeah? We have to build wider freestalls for bigger cows. And that makes sense to have a separate heifer group. We simply can make those freestalls a little bit narrower. We have less manure, etc., less maintenance. So this how it should be. Freestalls of 125, almost no contact between the cow and the divider, no lumps on the back, no thick hocks, etc. Yeah, and leave these animals with the neighbor. Eh? So what went wrong here? What do you think? What went wrong here? What's the cause?
Scrabbling to get up.
Why?
She hasn't got the length.
She hasn't got length, so it's a lack of lunge space. So it's only 240, 250. And what about the surface? Does the surface provide her enough grip? No, it's a hard, old, outdated rubber mat. So causing this type of problems. And this is better. Well-bedded. The well-bedded freestalls with straw. Thick layer of sawdust, sand. And if you see this picture, what is your impression? What's your first impression?
Happy cows.
Happy cows? Yeah. Why they are happy? They're all lying down. A rule of thumb, 85% of the cows which have contact with the freestall should lie down. Do you understand that? So. Contact with the freestall, that's of course lying, that's of course standing with all her 4 feet inside the freestall, that's standing with her front feet inside the freestalls. So that are animals who have contact with the freestall, 85% of them, as a rule of thumb, should lie down. So that gives an immediate and fast impression about how well the freestalls are designed. So, avoid design errors. The devil is in the details. So why we are happy to help you, also in cooperation with Mole Valley. It starts with a good plan. Yeah? Spend time on it. Joep said this morning, education might be expensive, but ignorance is. That's the same in our eyes about independent advice on barn design. Yeah? Might be expensive, but ignorance costs you much more money. Because we have to avoid design errors. Some examples, the bolts on waterers, bolts on head yokes, sometimes we see it. A concrete brisket locator, too high, too wide, not providing enough lunge space, too short beds. Together with the beds, we have all the four knees bruised. And why build a wall here? Why not leave it open? Yeah? Giving fresh air for those cows and more lunge space to get up. So we really want to get rid of concrete in between our cows. Some take-home messages. Consider de-bedded freestalls. Yeah? Not saying it has to be sand, just a question about it as well. Prevent overstocking at the feed bunk, especially for your transition cows. Okay, we can manage overstocking by feeding twice a day, by pushing up more often, by have a perfect mixed ration. Yeah. Pamper your transition cows, stress-free calving line, 5% at least of your cows on straw beds, excellent freestalls for your dry cows. Maximum ventilation for healthy cows. Yeah. Provide oxygen for the motor and take the daily time budget of your cows in mind. Okay, thank you for your attention. Some questions, Tom, here.
Yeah, any questions from the floor? Okay, let's go with these first, Bertjan.
How much feed space less can you get away with robotic milking? I would never choose for a 4-row barn. So if you talk about a 4-row barn, 4 rows of feed stalls in one row of head yokes, one feed bunk. So we have to get rid of that. But a 3-row barn functions well in the robotic system. So then we talk about a 6-row barn with outside feeding or with a central feed alley. So then we have feed bunk space for more or less 65% of our cows at the same time. That works well. In robot barns, you can find some solutions. What Jupe also explained, you have some extra space in front of the feed bunk, or in front of the robots. Cows can eat also beside the milking robot. So in a 6-row barn, we can nearly get 70 or 75% of our cows eating at the same time. And also in robot barns, that's the reason that I also still like 4-row barns, enough feed bunk space for every cow in robot barns. Also in robot barns, 20 minutes post-feeding, we see the most of the cows standing at the feed bunk. And we still do a lot of preg check and a lot of vaccinations at the feed bunk, also on dry cow operations, because that's easy. We don't have to sort out a large group of cows. So that's just a remark, yeah.
Best management solution seen for milking cluster hygiene in transition calving pens?
Yes, we love, yeah. You have the mini milkers, so the single milkers. Clean them thoroughly. So what you could do is just take the bucket also into the milking parlor. There are systems that we can also easily clean the bucket together with the whole milking system. It's a good question, because if we have the individual milkers, there's a big risk of not getting them clean enough after milking, because we are milking them only colostrum, fatty milk. So we have to pay extra attention. So best management solutions, I think a good cleaning protocol, hot water, acid, and disinfectant.
Do we provide enough environmental enrichment for the girls? A brush is enough?
If I would keep cows, I would at least give them access, and it was not able for me for my farm, to for example, graze. I would at least give them access to open air. So I would open the ends of the barn, make a small corridor, paved with rubber, yes or no. I also love the solution that we have a corridor outside gated with some brushes in it. We see it quite a lot in Switzerland, because it's also the law that the cows always should have access to some vitamin D from the sun.
And then that's a specific question from somebody in here. How often, if at all, deep bedded cubicles, sand in this case, should be excavated and disinfected?
Yeah. It's
current cell count is 160 to 210.
So I believe that this farmer has a somatic cell count of 160 to 210. Excavated, none. That doesn't happen. Disinfected as well. In respect with sand, just pay a lot of attention on the top layer. So excavated and disinfected. No,
fully
excavation
removed.
not
fully
necessary.
Removed.
Yeah, excavation not necessary, so we can keep the layer inside. Key is the bedding management of the top 5% of the top 5 centimeter of the deep beds. Keep it level and keep it dry.
Have we done that one? Or if not, let's just say it again.
All three speak.
Well, you're on your own. You're on your own, son, because they've gone. So, discuss recommended stocking versus commercial US stocking, because I think you was talking about in California, the stocking densities are a lot lower than in New York State. So, and the effect on lameness and effects like that. Are we?
It's hard to to make the connection between the different countries. What you see in general, most of the research, most of the experience, just see more problems when barns are more and more overstocked, becoming more and more overstocked.
So what's your
aim? Our recommendation is go to 100%, and if you have a three-row barn for your transition cows understocked, that's also the general recommendation also in the USA, go to one-to-one feed bunk space, so understocked by 70-80%. With good management in the two-row barn, we never recommend overstocking, but with good management in the two-row barn, yeah, I think 5%, 10%. It's doable, yeah, without compromising feed intake, lying times too much. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Bertjan. That's been great.